Hello and a warm welcome to all our savvy investors. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, the word savvy describes each one of you. You must be thinking, why? So let us tell you. Well, all of you are savvy because by making the intelligent decision of attending today's session, you've pressed accelerator pedal on your path to potential long-term wealth. Sir, before we start, is there anything that you would like to say to our knowledge seekers?
We are at a very interesting threshold in India on investing. A lot of changes are happening to us as the country. A lot of changes are happening to us as individuals. We've been shut at homes for a year, and that has played a huge sort of impact on our minds as well as on our subconscious. So I do believe that life, like there was before Christ and after Christ in India, in consumption, there is before Maruti and after Maruti. I do believe that life is permanent COVID and after COVID. And that's where we are. So we have to, you know, relook each aspect of our life. As we know, we are very close to sort of death or life facing sort of life threatening sort of moment. Out of that, it will be a different world, make no mistake of it. So when we look at that, and investing and finances are a very important part of everybody's life, it is time to take a fresh look.
That was absolutely fantastic. Thank you very much, Mr. Mohanty. I mean, we absolutely loved how before Christ and after Christ and the crisis that we are facing right now, right? Everything will happen before COVID and after COVID. And ladies and gentlemen, that is none other than Mr. Swaroop Mohanty, Chief Executive Officer of Mirai Asset Investment Manager, India Private Limited. Sir has a whopping, ladies and gentlemen, a whopping 27 years plus of experience in financial services, including more than 20 years of experience in asset management sales. So future potential investors and current finance fanatics, both hearing this heavy duty introduction, you know that you are learning from the absolute best in the industry. And on that amazing note, I, Nikita Rana, your moderator for the session, welcomes you to Outlook Money and Mirai Assets Investor Education Series. Today, we'll be talking about global investments. So let's dive right into it. Mr. Mohanty, let me start off by thanking you for taking time off your super busy schedule to share your knowledge and experience. Sir and our lovely audience members, think of today as an educational coffee with Karan, minus the coffee and minus the Karan. By the way, before we start, are you more of a coffee kind of guy or a tea?
No, I'm a complete tea guy. Darjeeling is my go-to this thing. I just finished my tea, so I'm a very, very tea person. Unlike the rest of my family, the rest of the family are coffee drinkers.
Okay, so let's begin. Mr. Mohanty, our very first question to you is, with a plethora of options available, both nationally and locally, why do Indian investors need to consider investing in global markets?
Yes, Nikita, this is a very fundamental question. There is no doubt that India is probably one of the fastest growing economies in the world, but it still represents around 3% or 3 to 4% of the world's GDP. At the same time, it represents around 3 to 4% of, say, the world's market capitalization. Just the world, if the world total equity markets were 100, India would be 3 or 4 rupees out of the market. Further from today's world of, say, globalization, in which Indian investors are, already a consumer of several global companies, such businesses or such companies represent products which need to be part of their portfolio. When you look at, say, different countries, you know, different countries have come with their own strengths and variety. Say, let's look at different geographies. And if you look at US, say, US is a leader in, say, future technologies. Germany is brilliant at engineering. At the same time, what is common to, say, India and China are low-cost manpower. Hence, they will depend upon importing those technologies to India, their own strengths in these parts. Let's face it, India as a country is an emerging country or an emerging economy. So a lot of, what happens in India is very old economy when it compares to these progressive countries or maybe progressed countries. So let's look at, say, the four pillars in our country are, say, infrastructure, banking, healthcare and say consumption. While when you reflect that on say US, it will be in say hydrocarbon products or hydrocarbons more in Russia than in the US, but it would be more in technology, more in cloud computing, global companies which are more into say warehousing and gaming. These are companies which don't exist in India. So when you look at combining the two, one can have a better portfolio. Hence, investing abroad makes more sense. Add to the fact that the Indian markets have practically no correlation with the global markets. So then when you combine the two, your portfolio can become better structurally. Hence, it is advocated today that global investing or the time for global investing has come.
That's a fantastic answer, Mr. Mohanty. You know, there's a very popular saying in your world, right? You should never invest or keep all your eggs in one basket. So, multiple portfolios is the way to go. And what better way to have multiple than to go in a different country? Go globally, and like sir mentioned, right, it's all about the different various sectors which you mentioned, which are not as of now available in our country, and they will definitely for sure be in coming years. Sir, so you have convinced us to dip our toes into global investments. That was a brilliant answer to our question, but we as potential investors would request you to clarify a couple of our doubts on a couple of points, like what are the various issues that an investor should keep in mind before investing in a global fund? That's point number one. So how about you go ahead with this answer and then we'll take up point number two post the answer.
Fair enough. See, global investing or global funds aids diversification in the long run. But in the short run, they may be impacted by short-term currency movement. They may react to global political landscape also. There's been huge political change across globes, and we are all aware of the change in legacy that happens once the new political regime sort of comes in. Simply put, the volatility may be higher, as a result of which investors need to assess the funds depending on his or her investment risk profile along with their aim or objectives. That is point number one. You have to always marry your own risk profile to where you are investing. That is a fundamental rule of investing. Depending on this individual aim or objective, global investing can be a result of tactical asset allocation or strategic allocation. You can do both. Whether investors want to have a concentrated exposure to tech stocks because their sectors or segments is missing in India, or whether he wants to simply add a plain vanilla exposure to those markets, depends on the investor's risk and return profile. And that is what something should always keep in mind while investing, not only abroad, anywhere, you know, whether it matches your risk and report, more important, the objective of your investment plan. It is also important to evaluate, and this is a very important point, it's also very important to evaluate the fund's risk return profile in which investors intend to invest. While evaluating, the most important consideration should be what one is paying to the total cost of such funds. Globally, the financial markets, especially in the US and other developed markets, are very information efficient, as a result of which the cost becomes an important factor of investing. Remember, since cost reduces the returns since cost also reduces the cost of the investor returns. Higher the cost, the lower the return. So one should be a little wary of that too.
Thank you so much for that brilliant insight, Mr. Mohanty. Now that you know, just touching upon cost, right? So our point number two of the same question is, what are the tax and currency implications pertaining to global investments?
See, Nikita, when Indian investors invest in foreign assets, he or she are exposed to currency fluctuations, like I said in the last answer too. When the Indian rupees depreciates, the value of foreign assets increases and vice versa, right? That is the correlation. The value of Indian currency generally depreciates against developed economies, as the inflation in developed economies is typically lower than that of the inflation of India. Historically, post the global crisis in 2008, till say December 2020, the USD and the euro, that is the dollar and the euro, has appreciated against the Indian rupees by 3.4 odd and 2.32 per annum respectively. While in the shorter investment horizon, currency may fluctuate, over longer investment horizons, the Indian rupees has usually depreciated against strong currencies such as the dollar and the euro. And see, unlike the domestic equity markets, foreign funds are taxed as debt funds. This is one should remember, that you get a debt fund taxation when you invest in foreign funds. The short-term capital gains, that is investing holding period for less than 3 years in debt funds, are taxed as per the income tax rate of the investor. Long-term capital gains are taxed at 20% after allowing for indexation benefits. However, even after the post-tax basis, foreign funds can still create alpha for investors. One of the benefits of debt tax investors over long-term investment tenures is indexation. And indexation can reduce your tax liability substantially.
Ladies and gentlemen, I mean, firstly, I would actually like to thank our amazing audience members. So what an amazing, what a big reason for having an educational series like this. And Mr. Mohanty, I mean, it's not just education for them. I have been learning and I've been making points right from the get-go. To have the CEO himself do the talking, absolutely brilliant, sir. Thank you so much.
Nikita, I must tell you that, you know, this learning has been very recent. You know, global investing is not something which was very conversant earlier, but it's in the recent times that we woken up to the possibilities and the avenues have also increased, let's face it.
Absolutely. Mr. Mohanty, so from dipping toes to taking a deep dive into the ocean of global markets, I think that is how we'd like to put it. Mr. Mohanty, the more we listen to you, the more we realize the value of investing globally. Now that you have our rapt attention, the most obvious question in our minds is, how do I make this happen for myself? What are the various avenues, like you were just talking, what are the various avenues which are available to Indian investors to invest globally?
Typically, Nikita, there are two options available for Indian investors. One is obviously directly investing in stocks. The Indian investor can directly buy stocks from the foreign markets. Many Indian brokers have started providing the facility. However, investing via direct equities will be under the limit of the LRS of 2.5 lakh US dollars. Further, please remember that the operational costs incurred for transacting under direct investing are generally higher, and this also includes the forex conversation, right? In case of direct investing in stocks, investors sometimes need higher absolute amount to invest. Say, for example, just buying one stock on Amazon will be what, around 2.5 lakh rupees, just one stock. So this is relatively higher, and that's why it may not be feasible or viable for many retail investors. The other option is via mutual funds. You know, a lot of Indian mutual funds have started providing the avenue for investing in global markets via active mutual funds, which buy stocks directly. Amongst the mutual fund schemes, investors have option to opt for either, say, investing in active funds, which invest directly in certain stocks, or passive funds tracking the global indices, or via fund of funds, which invest into international funds, either domiciled or in other countries. These are the PIF fund I'm talking about. Please remember, investments via mutual funds do not fall under the LRS. Further, due to economies of scale, the operational costs actually distributed amongst all the investors in that fund. The economies of scale also result in exposure to global stocks at a very low initial investment of just 5,000 rupees. Compare that to 2.5 lakh for one Amazon stock, or in multiples of thereof, while investing via mutual funds, or you know, it goes to as low as rupees 50 in case of ETFs directly on exchange.
Wow, I mean, I'm actually taken by surprise. So Mr. Mohanty, correct me if I'm wrong. So you either pay EMIs to your house or buy Amazon stock, right?
These are not small companies anymore, and their market cap is just at a different level.
Oh my God. So, ladies and gentlemen, I mean, like Mr. Mohanty rightly mentioned, distribution and pool funding is exactly the way ahead. Sir, thank you for that brilliant, brilliant insight. I mean, I can't thank you enough, truly. And as we're still learning, right, and hence we need your guidance on an extremely important topic like this. Our next question to you is, as the exchange trade fund is a fairly new concept in India, being simply 2 decades old, the same age as me, long time back when I was 20, the very basis of ETFs is that it can be traded throughout the day, just like stocks, right? So how does foreign ETF work, considering the time zone difference? That's point number two. And post your answer, we'll take up point number two as well.
See, you know, when the two options available to the investor when it comes to him or her buying the ETFs, there are two ways. One, you can come with the AMC. The investor can come in a lot size directly to the AMC. There is a fixed lot size which the AMC sort of talks every time. And in that lot size, you can come directly to the AMC and buy it from us. The money should be provided by the investor before the closing of the Indian market hours. That is, before the closing market, the money should be transferred into our account. The AMC then deploys the money received in the evening in the US markets, as you were rightly pointing difference. And based on the deployment, the NAV is allotted to the investor. Please understand, it is on deployment that the NAV is allotted, not on the transfer of the money. That should be kept in mind. The other one obviously is on the exchange. The ETF will trade on the basis of quotes provided by the AP, which is the market maker. The quote will be based on the previous day close NAV, as well as the futures based on the US markets, which are live traded during the Indian market hours. The investor can buy and sell ETFs on the exchange just like stocks.
That's such a big relief to know. I mean, and I'm sure that comes across as a relief to so many of our Indian investors, because they just reassure that this has been taken care of, right? Indian investors have been taken care of. Okay, that's absolutely fantastic. So the part two of our question is, how can investors buy and sell them?
Yeah, like I said, they can buy either and sell them on the exchange itself. You know, they can trade it on the exchange, and this is on real-time NAV, which is provided by the AP of the market, or which is the market maker. The NAV or the quote in the market will be based on the previous day NAV close, as well as the futures based on the US markets, right? Which are live traded during the Indian market hours. The investor can definitely buy and sell ETFs on exchanges, just like you buy and sell stocks.
That's absolutely fantastic to know. Mr. Mohanty, this was the last question for the session. Is there anything that you would like to say as a closing note to our amazing audience members?
See, yeah, I mean, when it comes to global investing, the only thing that I'd like to point out is, you know, the Indian stock market provides one avenue. Other markets provide completely different avenues. You know, the mega trends which are unfolding in the world, which are very futuristic in nature, can be caught into the portfolio through the viability or the availability of the funds right now. And if one wants to construct a significantly stronger portfolio, then one should get into some sort of global investing allocation before it is too late.
Absolutely, sir. We are sold. Absolutely. So that was fantastic. So ladies and gentlemen, with this, we come to the end of today's session. Thank you so very much, Mr. Mohanty, for your valuable time and insights. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me, Nikita.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for watching. With this, the second episode in our Investor Education series comes to an end. But we'll be back soon with our third. So keep following us to learn more. Until next time, stay safe, stay strong, and a great day, everyone. Thank you.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.